so beautiful, and that was the beginning of all of us being together. So I didn't tell him that I was gonna pull that up this morning. But I wanted to encourage you because God has something for you. I don't know what that is, but He's got something. It might not be something this big as moving somewhere, but it doesn't matter how big or how small it is. Say yes to Him today. Maybe you really don't know Him as your Savior today. Maybe you're not really sure that that's something that you've really done. You can nail that down today. You can talk to Him. I don't know what it is, but God's got something amazing for you. So say yes to Him today. So that's what I got. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus, so much for being here with us. This is your time to change our hearts, to do something amazing in each one of us. Help us to leave the junk that we dealt with last week, to leave it here at your feet, and to allow you to just change us from the inside out. May you be honored and glorified with the worship that we are about to offer to you. In Jesus' name I'm praying. Amen.
Amen.
All right. My microphone's definitely on. Wow. It just sounds loud to me today. I don't know. It kind of has to be a little bit, just because the live broadcast we have on Facebook. Hi, everybody. Mom, Dad, hi. At any rate, that kind of requires a little extra volume. But I think we're ready to get things rolling. So if you guys want it, go ahead and you can stand up if you want. If you don't, then stay seated. If you want to lift your hands and worship today, then go for it. If you want to clap, I won't complain. Whatever it is you feel like you need to do in order to get into the right zone to worship God, that's what I'm looking for. So let's go ahead and get things started with This Is Amazing Grace.
Yeah.
Yeah. Heal this heart of mine. All your sons and all your daughters, grace.
so grateful. So grateful that you've adopted us as sons and daughters. God, we ran away. We were the rebellious little kid, the punk kid who just couldn't live by your rules. We ran away. You took us back. You're so gracious, so good. And what you did for us on the cross just made it possible for us to have a real relationship with our Maker. I'm so grateful for that now. And I just look forward to eternity, getting to see your love and your glory unfold, God, getting to understand how you made things, yes, but mostly coming to understand you a little bit more every day. I just look forward to that now. That is what keeps me going. So thank you. I just ask you to be here today, God. We need you more than we'll ever really know, but God, I know we're desperate. May not feel that way. Maybe not today. Maybe not ever. I don't know. But God, we are sincerely desperate for your presence. And so we're just asking you to come here and speak to us. Teach us. Help us all walk away different than we were. Just thank you again for your love and grace. It's in Jesus' name I pray. We've been going through this series for a few weeks now. It's basically this idea called Get Life. Because in John chapter 8, not only does Jesus, do we hear the story about Jesus dealing with this woman in adultery, and instead of taking her life, in a very real sense, he gave it back to her and basically said, hey, let's not get back to this point yet in life, okay? And he turned around to the crowd and he said a huge and bold statement. He said, I am the light of the world. And that's one of those big statements that has probably meaning that I don't know that I'm ever going to understand fully this side of heaven. But I mean, to the extent that I do understand it, I see him making a very bold statement to a crowd that was not entirely friendly to him. I mean, we see that Jesus had a crowd of Pharisees and critics, but he also had some people who were genuinely interested in what he had to say. What it was that they were curious, because I mean, just going around the countryside, he's healing people, and he's doing miracles like feeding 5,000 people from one kid's lunch. And so we see those things and we start to wonder, at least I would if I were in that position. Okay, what this guy's got to say is probably legitimate. I really need to go hear what it is. So people are just dropping what they're doing, leaving their livelihood behind so they can go hear some of what Jesus has to say before they have to get back to life. They want to know. And Jesus is just laying it down. And he puts it out there and says, I am the light of the world. Now, if he were a normal rabbi, he could come along and say, you know, okay, we're here in Jerusalem, so I am a light here in Jerusalem. You guys need to listen to my teaching. Because I can explain the law of God better than most. And so, if you listen to me, your lives will be illuminated. But he didn't say that I'm a light in Jerusalem. He didn't even say I'm a light in Israel. He didn't even say, I'm a light in the world. He said, I am the light. That definite article, if you guys remember your grammar school days, makes all the difference. And he's saying it so that we'll understand what I've got to give you, no one else can. What you need to understand is that I'm the guy you've been waiting for. And he said it a bunch of different ways. Some of them not so subtle. And today we're going to get to probably the most bold of those statements, where Jesus just smacks people upside the head with the fact that he's saying that I am God. And so he's already engaged in this dialogue with his critics. I mean, it's just back and forth. And there's critics because they've come to the point in their life where they've heard what Jesus has to say, but they're just not willing to take it. So they've listened, they've heard him out, but they've only been listening enough so they can give a response. And you guys ever been in conversations like that? Because I'm extremely guilty of that. Listening just enough so that I can give a response. I'm starting to think ahead, okay, this is what I'm going to say, this is how I'm going to formulate, this is how I'm going to lead the conversation. Whatever it is that's going on inside my brain, but I'm only like 40% listening at that point. Which is one reason why, active listening, the skill that, I've been hearing taught in the last several years, listen so you can respond. You stop and you actually focus, you listen, and that way, when the person's done, you've got all the information, and then you can respond better. And maybe you got to have that second or two or three in order to be able to formulate your response. But it's better that way. But these critics, they're not in the mood for listening. They listened enough, and they were done with him, and they wanted no more of what Jesus had to say. So they're trying their best to shut Jesus down in front of everybody, discredit him, get him kicked out, and so they can go back to life as long as they've got the influence, they've got people's hearts in their pockets, and so that's what they're looking for. Jesus is coming, he's throwing everything out of whack, and they didn't like his message, and they didn't like the idea of who he could be. Because if this Jesus really was the Messiah, then, well, what are they needed for? What about my influence? What about, my teachings? I've been saying this, but you're coming along and saying, the law is good, but hey, I'm calling you to something better, something higher. And so... They're just trying to nitpick the law and make it expand the law so that it tries to cover every situation you could possibly run into. And it just, the problem is that when we do things like that, they were trying to motivate people, and pull out one of those 25 cent words, extrinsically. It means that the motivation was outside themselves. It wasn't powerful, it wasn't moving. It may be powerful and moving for a time, but when it's not really coming from inside us, it just wears off, it fades away. It's the common thing that I see it is when we as parents try to motivate our kids through guilt. And that works for a while. For that matter, we can motivate a church through guilt. I can say, you guys need to go out there, you need to share the gospel of Jesus Christ, because there's people out there who are dying and they don't know Jesus. And all that's true. I'm not saying it's not, but eventually what happens is people start to burn out. They can't maintain that emotional level, that emotional motivation for very long, and just guilt and shame just, we're not meant to carry that. We were never designed to deal with that emotion. We were designed for perfection. We were designed to live a life in the garden, walking and talking with God, and having a clear relationship with Him, having clear conscience, nothing like guilt. And so when we start using something like that to intrinsically motivate people, it just burns us out, because we're not designed for it. And so it's the same story here. These people, the Jews, are extrinsically motivated. They're trying to get people to do things because it's the right thing to do. And Jesus comes along saying, hey, you need to follow me. You need to get to know me. You know, I came to restore this relationship between God and man. We're told that our ministry as Christians is that we've been given the ministry of reconciliation. Stop and think about that. That's what our job is. We're here to give people the restoration in a relationship between them and God. That's what it's about. It's about that relationship. And Jesus understands that. He's trying to give that to people. He's trying to bring people into a relationship with Him, with the Father. And scribes, the Pharisees, the Sadducees, all these religious leaders of the day, they're just like, no. You don't understand. We've got to make sure that we do every little thing right. And it's just burning people out. It didn't work. It never has. And it never will. Because the law just isn't enough. Or I guess I should say it's more like we're not enough for the law. So Jesus came, He is enough, and He did all that. And that's why He's coming into this situation saying, I'm the light of the world. I'm the illumination that you need. If you want to be able to see things as they really are, you need me. Because you're not going to get it otherwise. You're going to go through life, and you're going to think you understand. And life will work to a large degree, but you just every once in a while, you'll just get this thing. This little voice in the back of your head that you're missing out on something. That it's not, something just doesn't jive, you know? And so he's saying, if you follow me, if you listen to my teachings, if you know me, then that's when you get it. And that's what he's talking about here. So he's had this back and forth with these guys, and we're going to pick it up. Verse 48. And so, if you remember last week, I'm going to go ahead and back up just a little bit to the paragraph beforehand. Verse 42 is where I'm going to start. Just to give you an idea of where we are in that conversation. So, chapter 8, verse 42 says, Jesus told them, if God were your Father, you would love me, because I come to you from God. I'm not here on my own, but He sent me. Why can't you understand what I'm saying? It's because you can't even hear me. For you are children of your father, the devil. And you love to do the evil things he does. He was a murderer from the beginning, and he has always hated the truth, because there is no truth in him. When he lies, it is consistent with his character, for he's a liar and the father of lies. So, when I tell the truth, just naturally don't believe me. Which of you can truthfully accuse me of sin? And since I'm telling you the truth, why don't you believe me? Anyone who belongs to God listens gladly to the words of God, but you don't listen because you don't belong to God. Oh, man. For people whose life centered around God, I mean, the Jewish people were very religious people. It was the center of their entire lives, their thought process. Everything in their culture was shaped around God and His law. And so for Jesus to come along and say, not only do you not know Him, but you know, your father, your real father, the one you're following, he's the devil. He is God's adversary. He's the one who tried to dethrone God in time long ago and failed and is destined to doom and failure. And he's a liar and he's a murderer, and you are doing the things that he does. These guys are getting picked off. I can't say without four-letter words. They are absolutely livid with Jesus at this point. So they basically just turn it around. They just throw out just the ugliest thing they can think to say in their minds. So verse 48, the people retorted, "You Samaritan devil! Didn't we say all along that you were possessed by a demon?" Jesus, "No," Jesus said, "I have no demon in me, for I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. And though I have no wish to glorify myself, God is going to glorify me. He is the true judge. I tell you the truth, anyone who obeys my teaching will never die." The people said, "Now we know you're possessed by a demon. Even Abraham and the prophets died. But you say anyone who obeys my teaching will never die? Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died, and so did the prophets. Who do you think you are?" Jesus answered, "If I want glory for myself, it doesn't count. But it is my Father who will glorify me. You say he is our God, but you don't even know him. I know him. If I said otherwise, I would be as great a liar as you are. But I do know him and obey him. Your father Abraham rejoiced, and he looked forward to my coming. He saw it and was glad." The people said, "You aren't even 50 years old. How can you say you've seen Abraham?" Jesus answered, "I tell you the truth, before Abraham was even born, I am." At that point, they picked up stones to throw at him, but Jesus was hidden and left the temple. So we see that this really heated conversation. I just really want you guys to stop and imagine. This is a crowd that is turning into a mob. Jesus said the exact things that would make them as angry as it's possible to make them. All they need is an excuse. The only reason they're holding back is because they're like, it's that whole commandment, thou shalt not kill. That's the only reason they're not already, that they hadn't grabbed stones earlier to try to kill them. They weren't willing to. Again, their life is focused around God's laws. But they've never gotten to the point where they could use those laws to see the heart of God. They didn't understand, as far as I could see anyway, they couldn't understand why it is that, you know, you should not kill. It comes back down to love the Lord with all your heart, mind, soul, and strength. They couldn't understand how not coveting your neighbor's possessions comes back down to ultimately love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength. They couldn't understand how all those laws point back to that simple thing, love God. So they didn't have a real relationship with him. They didn't know him. They knew of him. It hurt his reputation. It'd be like, you know, if I said, "Yeah, I know LeBron James. Yeah, he's a great basketball player." No, I don't know him. I know his name, and I know he's far better at basketball than I could ever have hoped to have been. And some people will argue he is the best. Some people will argue against, but that's for people who know more than I do. But the point is that they didn't know Jesus. Not really. They didn't know the Father. If they weren't willing to really use the law to see the heart of God, they were missing out. just couldn't bring themselves to do that. They weren't willing, because that means surrendering your heart, not just your actions. And that's something that there's not a human on earth that gives that up easily. That's why we all have to come to that point where we realize, I can't do it. I'm not good enough. And there's only one who is. There's only one who can. So, let's go ahead and back up. Let's take a closer look in on things. So, verse 48. The people retorted, "You Samaritan devil, didn't we say all along that you were possessed by a demon?" Like I said, they're just livid at this point. And so they're throwing out the ugliest things they can think of. And so they call him a Samaritan devil. So he's not only satanic in nature, but he's also kind of a half-breed Samaritan. And if you don't know, there's a lot of racism that we see in the Bible that's dealt with, and this is one of those examples. This is the Jews, in their mind, hated the Samaritans. It was to the point where, if they needed to go from one section, from like Jerusalem up into the north, they would actually go around, the long way around, just to avoid going to Samaria. And why is that? It's because Samaria was filled with people who were basically half-breeds. They were halfway Jewish and halfway the other nations that surrounded the countryside. So God had told people not to intermarry with those nations because they would lead their hearts away from the Lord. That's what happened. They intermarried. Their hearts were led away from the Lord. And some of them came back and had kind of found something that was an amalgamation of the other religions and Judaism, but it still wasn't quite the right thing. And so, religiously speaking, they were off track. And so the Jews hated them for that reason. They hated them for the reminder that in the past, their ancestors had messed things up and intermarried with people that they were specifically told not to. And so they hated them for that reason. And there's this racial tension all the time. And so when they're calling Jesus the Samaritan devil, it's like I said, this is as bad as it gets. So whatever that insult is to you, whatever would just really make your blood boil, they're trying to get Jesus to lose his temper. And honestly, I don't think he's personally, it's just my opinion, I think he does have a level of anger here. He's not like flipping tables or anything like that, but I just can't feature him dealing with people who are willfully not listening and keeping perfectly calm the whole time. I just can't see these people trying to trip Jesus up, trying to catch him in something they could use against him. And they're dealing with him like that. And I just can't feature him not having some righteous anger about that. Because anger itself is not a sin. It's just something that typically we use in the wrong way. And so it does lead to sin pretty often. But by itself, it's not. The Bible tells us, be angry, do not sin. So it's definitely a real possibility. Jesus was the absolute master of that and everything else for that matter. And like I said, this is just my opinion. So take it just as that. I'm not trying to say as a fact, but I just can't feature Jesus being perfectly calm and cool during this conversation. So at any rate, he gets in there and he goes right back to him and says, "No, I have no need for for I honor my Father, and you dishonor me. And though I have no wish to glorify myself, God is going to glorify me. He is the true judge. I tell you the truth. Anyone who obeys my teaching will never die. And he goes through this thing. He's saying that, you know, I'm honoring my Father. Everything I say is giving glory to God. He is being reverential, respectful, however you want to say it. Everything he's dealing with God, he's doing right. He's obeying the law perfectly. That's why he said earlier, you know, hey, if I've sinned, you know, none of you guys can find anything in me that you can truthfully accuse me of that can be called sin. You just can't do it. And it's just not there. And I'm honoring my Father. He says, if you love me, you love the Father. If you know me, you know the Father. And so he just really latches on to that whole idea. And he pushes it further here. He says that, you know, I'm honoring my Father, but you are dishonoring me. Which basically kind of, with that whole line of reasoning, basically says that whether they realize it or not, they are dishonoring the Father. Which isn't something they would consciously try to do. But it is the reality of the situation. That's where they were. So, he does that, and he turns around and says, towards the end there, says, I tell you the truth, anyone who obeys my teaching will never die. So another bold statement that you just don't hear people say. Because while most teachers would say, you know, if you listen to what I'm saying, if you do what it is I'm teaching you, it's going to help you out in life. Maybe even help you live a longer life. Because if nothing else, I mean, there's the commandment, you know, honor your father and mother, and it may go well with you in your old age. Something like that. I don't have that exactly memorized. But that's still, that's one of the Ten Commandments. It's the only commandment with a promise. And so, some regular teacher would come along and say, hey, look, if you do what I'm telling you, it's going to help you out. But I don't think there's a single teacher out there who would be crazy enough to say, if you follow my teachings, you're going to live forever. And what is it that he's teaching here? He's teaching us who he is. It's not about a thing to do. It's about who he is. So, again, the point of the Gospel of John is to convince us that Jesus is who he said he is, that he is God with us. And so we need to understand that. That's what he's trying to drive this whole crowd towards. It's this inescapable fact that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. So he hits it. He just says it point blank. He says that, you know, I tell you, anyone who obeys my teaching will never die. Of course, they flipped out over that. People said, now we know you're possessed by a demon. Even Abraham and the prophets died. But you say, anyone who obeys my teaching will never die. Are you greater than our father Abraham? He died, and so did the prophets. Who do you think you are? It's like, finally, they're asking the right question. They got the wrong attitude about it. They're finally asking the right question. Who is it that you think you are? Are you greater than our father Abraham? And he answers, yes. Yes, he is. He doesn't answer in prep though, like that, though. He gets in and he says in verse 54, for if I want to glorify myself, it doesn't count. And I want to stop and read the next sentence. But it is my Father who will glorify me. And this is the way the kingdom works. We see it within the Trinity, within Father, Son, Holy Spirit, you know, the Holy Trinity. There's God in three persons. There's only one God. He has three persons that are distinct. They have different roles. I would probably even say different personalities to a large degree. The point is that within that Trinity, the Father glorifies the Son. The Father glorifies the Spirit. The Spirit glorifies the Father. The Spirit glorifies the Son. And the Son glorifies the Father. And the Son glorifies the Spirit. And that's just the way things go. You don't see them bragging on themselves like that. They don't glorify themselves. They glorify the other parts of the Trinity. And this is the kingdom principle we need to latch on to, because if we're doing something to build our glory, to build our influence, to build something for ourselves, we are at best misusing what God has given us. And that's just the best spin I can put on it. Because what God gives, He gives us to serve others. Jesus Himself said, I didn't come to rule over you, I came to be a servant. And so if our attitude's anything different than that, then we're not in the right place. And Jesus is trying to show them that at this point. That's just not the way the kingdom works. I don't know, these people are all about building their own platform, building their own influence. And He's just saying, no, no, you guys don't get it. I'm not trying to glorify myself. It doesn't count if I do, but it is my Father who will glorify me. You say He's our God. You don't even know Him. I know Him. If I said otherwise, I would be as great a liar as you. But I do know Him and obey Him. Your father Abraham rejoiced as he looked forward to my coming. He saw it and was glad. People said, you aren't even 50 years old. How can you say you see Abraham? Jesus says, I tell you the truth. Before Abraham was born, I am. Now, we look at that in English, that's bad grammar. But this isn't a grammar lesson. This is a lesson in the person of Jesus. This is all about who He is. And that's why He's laying it down. He is totally trying to reach these people, trying to tell them, not giving them an option anymore to ignore who He is. He's putting and He's making them make a choice. If you're for me, you're for the Father. If you are against me, you're against the Father. If you're for me, if you follow my teachings, you get eternal life. If you don't follow me, if you don't follow my teachings, then you have eternal punishment waiting. And it's just that simple. He comes in. And He's just saying, hey, I'm telling you the truth. Before Abraham was even born, I am. He's referring back to the proper name of God. If you guys remember back in Exodus, Moses is talking to God in the burning bush, and God's finally, I guess you could say, put aside some of Moses' fears. And Moses asks, okay, I'm going, but who do I say sent me? And he's asking for something that had never been given before. We've all seen lots of names for God in the Bible. We've been making up names for Him for thousands of years. You know, El Shaddai, God Almighty, or Jehovah Rapha, God is our healer. We've got, I think, at least 80 names, if my memory serves, that the Bible gives us for God. But there's only one name that He gave Himself back then, and that was, I am that I am. And that's what Jesus is referring to. He's laying it down. He's saying it as bluntly as can be said. He said, I existed before Abraham, I inescapable at this point. Every single person who heard what Jesus was saying in this crowd is faced with a decision in this moment. Am I going to believe him? Or am I going to stone him to death and blaspheme? Because those are pretty much the only two legitimate choices for any Jew. You're going to either have to believe him or you're going to have to kill him. And we see that the crowd pretty much makes a choice. Verse 59, at that point they picked up stones to throw at him. But Jesus was hidden from them and left the temple. It wasn't time yet. Jesus told them, point blank, I am God. You have to make a decision. You have to decide today, right here, right now, are you going to follow me or not? Are you going to believe me or not? Because if you believe me, if you follow me, if you follow my teachings, you have eternal life. You're going to get to hang out with Abraham. Don't. In the end, they had to make that choice, and it's the same choice we have to make, because we face this fact all the time. Now, obviously, when we became Christians, we faced that. We had to decide, okay, do I really believe these claims that Jesus is God, that he is the only sacrifice, the only way to the Father, or not? Am I going to believe that Jesus is who he said he was, and that what happened at the cross paid the price for my sin, or not? But we still face these decisions every single day. Every single day we come face to face with this idea, is God who he said he was, who he is? Or am I not going to believe him? Because every single situation we come into, we're still having that choice. It's a choice. It's a decision we affirm or deny day after day. Are we really going to believe him? Are we going to take him at his word? Are we going to believe him in a way that's real and changes our life? Because we make two different choices when we believe that God is who he says he is, and or if we're going to deny him at that point. There's two very different results. You know, for some people, it might be the choice between, you know, am I going to choose to use drugs again or not? Or maybe the choice to, am I going to cheat on a test? All these little choices we make every day. Because living for Jesus is all day, every day. It's all these little decisions that feel small. But every single time we're making a decision whether or not to follow him, whether or not to believe him. Now, are we going to believe that Jesus really is Emmanuel, that he really is God with us? He's with us every moment, and he's trying to lead us in a way that is gracious and loving, but he sets a hard pace. I don't know if you guys know this, he does. When we're following him, he sets a hard pace. Because he's not satisfied with us the way we are. He wants us to be in a better place. He's, in a very real sense, spiritually speaking, Jesus is like Moses leading us to the promised land. And every single step, we have to make that choice again. Are we going to follow him or not? Are we going to believe him or not? Are we going to believe that life is better his way, or are we going to think that it's better our way? These people, this crowd, for the most part, was not willing to believe him. They took up stones, and they were planning on stoning him to death, but basically he slipped away. It wasn't time for him to die yet. He had more things to do, as we're going to see. But he just doesn't give us the option to sit out and not make a decision. He doesn't give us the option to just wait and see. Because even waiting, even sitting out, it's still a decision. And it's wrong. But we still need to face that. We face it every day, just like that crowd. And whether or not we believe him in that moment shows what's in our heart in that moment. Thank God for his grace, as he does forgive us. And he, when we stop following him, he turns back, he comes back for us, and he, you know, he helps us again. But he's still going to set that hard pace because he knows we're not where we're supposed to be. He wants us to be somewhere, place good. So, again, the question comes down to, are you going to follow him? Are you going to believe that what he did on the cross is good enough not only for your eternal salvation, but for your day-to-day life? Because that makes a big difference. So we're going to have just a little time of invitation. So if you need prayer, this is your time. Doesn't matter what it's for. If you're finding yourself making those decisions where you're showing that you're not quite ready to believe him, he's back. Pray with you. If there's anything else going on in your life, this is it. This is your chance to go and pray. And we're going to go ahead and listen to a lost my own. My computer operator. Caleb, can you step up? Okay, she kind of knows. All right. Well, I got a song, Austin. So if you want to sing the song, sing the song. If you want to sit and listen, soak in the words, do it. Go back and pray. Go do that. You should be able to click on the song, first slide of the song. There we go. Thank you. Jesus, I come again. I'm so grateful for what you did on the cross for us and how you lead us every day, choice by choice, through the good times, through the hard times, through it all, God. You're there. And we just know you're everything, God. The more I consider what you did on the cross, the more I'm blown away by it. I just pray that never changes. Don't ever let me forget. Don't ever let me get distracted from you, who you are, and what you've done for us. And just work in our hearts, God. Remake us into who you want us to be so that we can do the works that you've prepared for us to do. Thank you so much. It's in the name of Jesus I pray. Amen. All right. So I got a couple announcements before I cut to this. Again, want to say you're formally invited to a community group Friday nights at 6 o'clock. It's going to be at my house. And we had a good time this last time. And I think God was glorified through it all. And that makes it about the best thing it can be. So, again, if you can just make it, I think you're going to find it well worth it. Other thing I wanted to say is that we're going to be starting up the Embrace Grace classes, basically. It's going to be starting September the 8th. And there you've got the information. It's going to be Thursdays. We're going to be doing it at 5:30. It's Embrace 5. It's for single moms. And then also Embrace Legacy, which is something we're trying to get going for the guys. So if you know any guy who's a single dad, he just needs a little help figuring out who he is in Christ and how to parent beyond that moment. Because no one likes to live reacting to life all the time. We want to be able to live life in a way, and parent in a way that leaves basically a legacy that has eternal significance. So that's what these things are about. So I just want to encourage you, if you know anybody. Are you a single dad? No? Might be a little weird.
Probably have some wisdom to offer.
Yeah, I bet you do.
We are going to the courthouse. There, you got $10. Jeff is a 49-year-old husband and father. So there is a meal you can drive free. You don't have to stay. But that's where our family is headed. $10.
Yep. So, if you got the time, if you got $10 or multiples thereof for your people, that's a great thing. That's a good reason to go help somebody out. That's what church is at least in part about. It's about loving other people. So, if you can, that's down at the square. It's going on right now. So, I believe they're stopping it at 2. Okay. So.